President and Chief Executive Officer of Itron in 2019. He joined Itron in 2015 as Executive Vice President and COO and has played a major role in shaping the company's strategy to partner with cities and utilities to deliver industrial IoT solutions. Please join me in welcoming Tom Deitrich to the keynote stage. It's a beautiful day.
Thank you, Stephanie. I'm sure my wardrobe can't keep up, but welcome to DistribuTech 2023. It is great to see everyone inside of this room, especially here in sunny San Diego. I would contrast that with what many of you have been dealing with in terms of weather. So maybe 3 weeks ago, if you were from Northern California, you had atmospheric rivers, one after the other, creating massive flooding. If you were in the Northeast 2 weeks ago, you had the polar vortex with negative triple digit wind chill factors. And in my home state of Texas, last week, we had an ice storm. The ice storm was helpful for me, though. It did help me understand the answer to an age-old question. If a tree falls in the forest, it indeed does make a sound. See, what you need to understand is we had about 24, 36 hours of freezing rain in Austin, Texas, and it coated everything with about 3/4 of an inch of solid ice. Now, this completely shuts down the city. And in that eerie silence of nothing moving around because you can't get outside lest you slip and fall, you hear the sound of cracking branches and trees coming down under the weight of the ice. Now, I've given you three examples in the last 3 weeks in just the US alone of some of the weather volatility. And that ice storm in Texas was followed by 24 hours later, where we had sunshine and mostly the sound of chainsaws with everyone trying to clean up. But what you see, though, is that weather disruption is real. It is something that is happening all around us. Climate disruption is just one of the reasons that I think the grid is at an inflection point. The weather volatility is one factor, but we have changes in generation. More and more renewables coming online, which is good from a sustainability point of view, but it creates fluctuations in supply. You've got changes in social patterns. Something like COVID happens, all of a sudden everyone is working from home, and where people work, how they work, where they live has changed pretty dramatically. You have changes in how the transportation sector is working, with more and more EVs coming on to the grid. And when that happens, an EV has a much, much different demand pattern than what a normal predictive demand pattern would have looked like from a grid design perspective. Suddenly you've got massive loads that are coming on and offline in an intermittent fashion. All of these things that I'm talking about hits the distribution grid literally and figuratively at ground zero. And when that happens, you've got to figure out how to deal with that complexity. And I'm here to tell you that it's going to keep on growing. By the year 2025, according to Gartner, there will be 50% more distributed energy resources behind the meter than there will be in front. Creating a reliable, resilient, secure grid in that kind of complexity is a very, very different problem than what we have faced in the past. And that's why I would say we are at the point of inflection of what will change. Now, that is exciting, a little bit scary at times, but I think the answer to how we deal with that complexity lives in the power of data, and specifically real-time data. When you can take advantage of real-time data, you can solve problems like supply and demand balance at a localized level. You can deal with all of those changes in what the grid looks like with distributed energy resources. You can deal with changes in consumers in terms of how they want to interact with the grid, the insight they would like to have in terms of interacting with a service. You can deal with outage. You understand where things are starting to go bad and can perform proactive maintenance. You can understand where distribution transformers are starting to become overloaded with more and more EVs in a particular cul-de-sac, as an example. All of the benefits that I'm talking about, I think, are pretty well known. I didn't say anything particularly insightful from the research that we had done, documented in the resourcefulness report from Itron for 2022. 9 out of 10 utility executives, all of you, said the use of data is absolutely critically or very important, so top box kinds of scores. Where the research got to be a lot more interesting, though, is not everyone has access to that data. That's pretty clear, working on it, but it isn't there yet. But even those that have access, only 20% of utilities believe that they are using that data adequately today. And therein is the opportunity for us to really deal with that complexity. And that importance of real-time data really is the key to success. So are we ready to be able to deal with these challenges? Can we make use of the data? I think we've got a lot of the basic building blocks in place today. And it starts with enabling a much more dynamic grid. What do I mean by that? So first and foremost, let's get visibility all the way out to the edge. That connectivity helps you understand what's happening in real time. It helps you understand and gain visibility into to what is present, which we don't often have today. But when you've got visibility into that presence, you can understand the capability. Hey, there is a battery behind this meter. Here's how much the capacity is and what the charge level is in that battery. With that knowledge, bringing it back and looking at it through a centralized point of view to understand what is present, but also understanding at the edge what is next door to each other, we can start to utilize all of these different distributed assets to balance supply and demand, to create that resiliency that we are seeking and optimize a cost point and maintain a quality of service that would not be possible without the use of the real-time data and enabling a very dynamic grid. So what is a perfect example that I'm talking about here? It is distributed intelligence, which is the name that Itron has for being able to put those endpoints out in the field, being able to download applications or agents into to those endpoints to understand what is happening and be able to take local action. And when you do that, you can start to understand things about the grid. We have more than 5 million of those distributed intelligence-capable endpoints in the field today and more than 7 million applications running in the field, and I'm sure we've just scratched the surface. Today, we can do things for a safety application, understanding if there's broken neutral or a high impedance, a high temperature kind of situation, which could indicate safety. You can understand where there is an EV, so you can start to think about optimizing when you would want to charge, how much you would want to charge. Do you want to use some of that energy in the EV to put it back into the grid? You can start to establish a much closer relationship with the consumer, because solving this distributed energy resource problem in a fully optimized way is going to take a different level of trust between all of us and the consumers that use our products. What level of trust would it take for you, for that consumer to say, okay, it's okay to use some of the charge in my EV to provide power back to the grid? That level of interaction and in trust is something that we have to work hard to garner in the years ahead. But this all just starts with the ability to get that visibility with those endpoints in the field today. I've given you just a couple examples that we have in the field today, and there are scores of people within the sound of my voice now that are developing additional applications to further this cause moving ahead. So I am extraordinarily optimistic as we gather this week. It will take a village, or actually, if I look around this room, I think we passed the village stage. We are already a small city, so it will take all of us contributing to solve the depth and breadth of this problem, but amazingly optimistic about what we can do together. Look forward to exploring those possibilities with all of you. Thank you for your attention this morning. Look forward to learning from you this week. Enjoy the great weather. Enjoy the show. Thanks very much.